The ironic thing is that a few years later, Gloria Steinem married Christian Bale's father. So she was very instrumental in getting Christian Bale the role.
You know, Ed and Tim revived that occasional frenzy over NC-17 films for a time, where and my recollection was that the particulars at that time were that it was at a certain level popular, but there was a great resistance, I think, among the video chains of carrying an NC-17 video that was an actual commercial product versus one that they would do with the pornographic product. What is your feeling about the rating system? Which, you know, you've been basically, your company was founded right on the heels of the MPA rating system being adopted. And what are your thoughts about the system? And what are your thoughts about the efficacy of the NC-17 rating?
I think that young audiences get into anything they really want to get into. The rule in Hollywood has been you can't make a big story if it's R rated. And that was the truth. When you go back, I guess, to earlier periods, like the Revolution movie, The Last Tango in Paris, Midnight Cowboy was X-rated, so there was a period before that, but just around that same time, where X-rated to me didn't seem to matter. And people were going to Midnight Cowboy and everyone was watching it. I think, I don't know if today Midnight Cowboy would be an X, but yeah. VR, and what's the last X-rated commercial success?
Well, I think in the wake of those successes, that's when they switched over to the NC-17 rating, right? Because X became so closely identified with pornography, right? So-called pornography, that the X just didn't work for a Hollywood, so-called Hollywood film anymore. You know, in that regard, you know, looking at things like this lovely trailer they put together, you know, in these past 50 years, it's been, you have witnessed hands-on an industry that's been in a constant state of turmoil and evolution and revolution, and everything from the adoption of the rating system to the advent of the pervasive advent of cable television in the homes of America, to the VHS revolution, to video stores, to the demise of video stores, to Laserdiscs, to DVDs, to streaming services, and now, you know, they all have the ability to carry around the film while they're in their pocket. Have motion pictures fundamentally changed? Has their place in our lives as viewers had a change?
I think that the motion picture as a recorded experience with an audience will last the same way the theater has lasted for thousands of years. It's a form that is valid and the experience is unique. The difference over the years you talk about video and disc and list. Through that whole period of television and all the changes that occurred, the film was preeminent, the motion picture. And there were always different ways of trying to find ways to get them made. I say, when I started producing films, there were five companies that bought films and distributed them. So in that sense, the more places to go, the easier to see films get made, much harder to get them marketed because it's so competitive. It's so expensive. But what's happening now is going more radical than anything that we talked about. Because the film itself is being questioned as a form, and we find ourselves, Richard Stanley wants to do Dr. Moreau, and he's preferring to do it as a miniseries because H.G. Wells' book, he thinks, could never be captured in 90 minutes. And the drive to TV and to streaming has raised the question of the position of the feature in a way that never was during this past 50 years to me. If I wanted to raise a lot of money in Wall Street, I don't think I could do it trying to raise money just for features. The future is seen as almost anti-future. So what's Katzenberg's company called?
Quibi.
Yeah, they've got billions of dollars in making films that last 3 minutes, and that's in your mind the future. And that is a radical change. It's not a difference between this and television.
It brings me to, I think, two questions. And one's more of a producer type of question. It's about, I guess, commoditization of feature films. Once upon a time, it seemed to me that if you had a film that didn't open up, there were ways that you could resurrect it, right? You could go, in the good old days of the small markets, you could take something, you could go, you could work it, you could find ways to repackage it, remarket, find new ways to promote it. Sometimes you might want to recut, and you might be able to give it life again. It seems to me that now there are far fewer ways to try to find second chances for features.
Absolutely. When we did Badlands, when we did Phantom, both films failed on their first go-round. The studios basically dropped them, and we found our own little formula to re-release both films by doing our own TV commercials, which haven't been done before for those films, doing new artwork for the poster, and newspapers, and we found that the smallest market that had a significance in the trade, in marketing films, was Little Rock, Arkansas. So we opened both films there, and we could buy and saturate the market for $30,000. And we did it for both films, and both films worked. And then in each case, we went from Little Rock to Memphis, and that was a bigger city. We had the map, the pattern, and we were able to succeed there. And then we went to Dallas, and the film succeeded there. And then the studios took it back and re-released both films. It was wild, we blew our way. And the second time around, both films did better. The first one, we could never do that now. I guess you could with the internet, and there are ways to market it without spending money and somehow compete. But then, you could compete with the studio in terms of television, traditional ways of marketing.
Do you think it'd be possible with a film like Badlands to have the impact today that it had been? In other words, for a film like it, it's not what they call a tentpole, it's not a franchise film. It's a film. It's a film that, in certain ways, is about cinema. It's a sort of an unleashing of emotions and sometimes dangerous emotions told through sound and vision. And it's the kind of movie that makes you fall in love. At least maybe, and made a lot of people, I think, fall in love with movie making, with the notion that you could create something that was beyond just the experience of being entertained. Do you think that's really possible today to make people fall in love with the notion of cinema again, rather than the notion of just film and features as being a form of everyday entertainment? I hate to sound pessimistic, but I do wonder.
Sure. I look at a film we did 2 years ago called The Man in the Infinity, Turn the Iron. And the audience's reaction to it, whenever I saw the film or experienced it with a real theater audience that was full, it was remarkable. It had the kind of impact you could only hope for. To spread that beyond the narrow demographic that is attracted to it is difficult, but for those people who saw it, it had, still had that power. And film, it's more segmented, I guess. But I would think that obviously, films break through that are considered higher on maybe not cinema in the sense that you're talking about. Is a film like The King's Speech an anomaly? Or is it generally the case where like three or four smaller films that are not pre-sold, not sequels, do break through, but they don't have the same cultural impact that films did have, because films, I guess I'm not into rap music, so I see music not as powerful as it was, but that's not true. It's a different type of music. That's the impact. It's a good question, but I think bottom line, features will survive. It's going to see years.
Now, I'm going to open things up to questions if there are any from the audience, but before I do that, I have one last question, and it's really something I'd just like for you to talk about, and that is the Pressman name in films is no longer your own, is it? I mean, you have a dynasty, so it's not only in the talents that you've nurtured, but you have family members who've come along now in the business, and I thought it'd be nice if you could talk about that.
Absolutely. My son Sam is here. Wearing a Salvador Dali mustache, which he still will not cut until the film starts shooting next May. And my wife Annie has just arrived. Are key parts of the company. And I think it's in good hands. And Sam really is a passionate film buff. Great to see.
Excellent. We don't have a great deal of time yet, but are there any questions from the audience? Yes, sir.
So, Mr. Pressman, thank you for coming tonight. You have had a really eclectic collection
Can everyone hear? Okay.
It's the filmmaker. In other words, most of the films are the work of an individual writer, director, and their expressions of their personality, vision, and you know, like to say that Conan Sisters were as valid and creatively original, express the voice as much as Badlands or Two Stories, but films that are considered more highbrow, but they both reflect filmmakers who are trying to stretch the envelope of their type of film.
And it's just lately, we've had a couple of pictures like The Hunt, which was pulled from distribution before release, largely due to political pressure. The Joker, which ended up blowing the top off the box office, was getting heavily criticized before it opened by people who clearly had not seen it yet, because I can tell you as a critic, Warner Brothers wasn't screening it around here before it opened. Do you worry that this type of, I mean, Warner Brothers did not cave on The Joker, Universal did cave on The Hunt. Do you worry that this type of social or political pressure is going to have a chilling effect, at least where the big studios are concerned, on making movies that have to be done?
I think that's a big question, which goes all the way to the White House.
It also goes beyond it, doesn't it? Because it also goes to China.
Yeah.
That's true. Now that, you know, the Chinese market, which was the second biggest market in the world, and had grown from nowhere, as you know, is now a big, big question mark because of political pressure. And I hope that this country doesn't allow that kind of thing to happen. Lots to worry about under current. Yeah, I think you're right to be concerned. We have a film that Jean-Claude Van Damme wanted to do. Sam is working with Oliver Stone's son on developing this idea. It was called NKVD. No, JC.
North Korea
Van Damme. North Korea, that's it. North Korea Van Damme was based on some true stories. They were about a big Hollywood action star who's the favorite of the president of North Korea. And they kidnap him, it's also for the character to be played by Jean-Claude to have a new career in North Korea. And then, as we were working on it, I think the interview came out.
Oh, man.
Last night at Phantom him a Winnipeg, Eddie responded, and I thought, Eddie, you talked a little bit about your response to the Phantom of Winnipeg documentary last night, and also this film, the Michael Brody film that has moved you so much. So, I do, thank you.
Michael Brody is a, it's a film called Dear Mr. Brody. And it's a film that I started to make about 25 years ago. What year was it, Sam?
1975.
75, so it's a lot more than that. About a young man who inherited a small fortune as the oil margarine heir. And it was the end of the flower power period. And he decided to give away his money to anyone who asked for it. And when that was announced, he was on it. Solid movies on every news show, every Time magazine, everything like that. And hundreds of thousands of letters came in from all over the world. And Brody ended up killing himself because of all kinds of pressures and the impossibility of making this deed, because he was slightly crazy because he didn't have nearly as much money as he claimed. But he was a noble idiot. I kept these letters in a garage, and Annie would say, throw these things out. Tons of boxes. I wouldn't throw that out for some reason. And then some of the work for me moved to Austin and had seen the letters and introduced the letters to a filmmaker named Keith Maitland. We've done a film called The Tower. It's a documentary about the first mass killing at the Austin, Texas Tower. It was a very good documentary. And he wanted to make a feature of his letter and find the people. It's an incredible movie. And we're submitting it to Sundance. It's not shown yet. But that and Phantom of Winnipeg are, I see why I brought it up, because that was a film that also brought tears to my eyes because of the emotional impact of seeing real emotion.
So much more.
Thank you.
Thank you.